Doctores y doctoras, sentaos y cubríos. Se abre la sesión. La señora vicedecana de posgrado y coordinación de estudios de la Facultad de Ciencias Económicas y Empresariales se dignará a conducir y acompañar a la presencia de los aquí reunidos al candidato al grado de doctor honoris causa, el señor William Thompson. Por la madrina, la doctora Carmen Bebía, la laudatio del candidato.
Rectora magnífica de la Universidad de Alicante, querida Amparo, ilustrísimo director general de universidades, señor vicerrector de investigación, querido Juan, señora vicerrectora de Relaciones Internacionales y Cooperación para el Desarrollo, querida Rosa, señora secretaria general, querida Esther, querido William, dignísimas autoridades, comunidad universitaria, señoras y señores. Es un privilegio presentar esta laudatio en reconocimiento al profesor William Thompson. Para mí y muchos de mis colegas, William representa más que un profesor o mentor. Su influencia ha sido fundamental en nuestra educación y el desarrollo de nuestras carreras. Su relación con la Universidad de Alicante ha dejado una huella profunda y significativa, como quedará reflejado a lo largo de esta laudatio. William Thompson inició su formación académica obteniendo el diploma de ingeniero de la Escuela Politécnica en París en 1972. Y culminó con un PhD en Economía en la Universidad de Stanford en 1976. Comenzó su andadura profesional en la Universidad de Minnesota y en 1983 se integró en la Universidad de Rochester, donde actualmente es Elmer Milliman Distinguished Professor in Economics. Ha sido profesor visitante en instituciones como la Universidad de Harvard, Universidad de Caen, la Paris School of Economics, entre otras muchas. ha tenido un papel significativo en el ámbito editorial y de liderazgo. Ha sido miembro del Consejo Editorial de revistas como Social Choice and Welfare, Journal of Economic Theory, Games and Economic Behavior y editor del International Journal of Game Theory. Además, presidió la Society for Social Choice and Welfare entre 2004 y 2006. Es fellow de la Econometric Society, the Society for Economic Theory y la Game Theory Society. Ha escrito más de 100 artículos publicados en las revistas de economía más prestigiosas del mundo y ha contribuido con 11 publicaciones entre libros y monográficos en editoriales de renombre como Cambridge University Press, MIT Press, Springer Verlag y Princeton University Press. William Thompson es un líder indiscutible en el análisis axiomático y estratégico de la asignación de recursos. Su objetivo ha sido derivar rigurosamente, a partir de axiomas fundamentales, reglas que posean propiedades normativas y estratégicas deseables. Entre sus numerosas contribuciones, ha estudiado reglas de asignación de recursos en diferentes contextos, como el establecimiento de listas de espera, la programación de actividades, la distribución de bienes privados, el pago a acreedores en situaciones de bancarrota o la provisión de bienes públicos. Me gustaría destacar hoy aquí tres de sus libros por razones muy diferentes. El primero, porque muestra una de sus líneas de investigación más relevante. El segundo, porque refleja su capacidad formativa y divulgativa. Y el tercero, porque muestra su generosidad hacia los jóvenes investigadores. Empezamos por el primero. How to divide when there isn't enough, from Aristotle, the Talmud and Maimonides, to the axiomatic of resource allocation, publicado en Cambridge University Press en 2019. ¿Cómo dividir el valor de liquidación de una empresa en quiebra entre sus acreedores? Esta cuestión, que se refiere a un problema muy concreto, se puede reformular como ¿cuál es la mejor manera de adjudicar reclamaciones sobre un recurso cuando la suma de esas reclamaciones excede la cantidad o el valor de ese recurso? Muchos problemas reales se ajustan a esta definición más allá del problema de liquidación de una empresa en bancarrota. Por ejemplo, ¿cómo administrar los recursos hídricos entre diferentes usuarios, agricultores, empresas, comunidades, gobiernos y ecosistemas naturales? El reparto de una herencia, la distribución de las cuotas de emisión de gases de efecto invernadero entre diferentes países o regiones, o la distribución del espectro de radiofrecuencias entre diferentes servicios de comunicación. William analiza estos problemas desde un punto de vista normativo, a través de propiedades que reflejan justicia distributiva y que deben ser compatibles con los incentivos individuales. Esto subraya la importancia de ajustar los aspectos normativos y estratégicos, teniendo en cuenta los incentivos individuales para asegurar que las soluciones propuestas no solo sean justas, sino también implementables en la práctica. Esta línea de investigación resalta la interacción crucial entre la economía y el derecho, proporcionando una base conceptual para informar decisiones legislativas y normativas sobre, por ejemplo, la liquidación de activos y el reparto entre acreedores. Estos enfoques interdisciplinarios pueden conducir a la creación de leyes más justas y eficientes. Su segundo libro, En The Axiomatics of Economic Design, An Introduction to the Theory and Methods, publicado en Springer en 2023, William muestra su vertiente pedagógica y divulgativa. El libro está escrito en forma de respuestas a preguntas de un joven curioso por el diseño de mecanismos de asignación de recursos. Describe el informe axiomático del diseño, formulando criterios de deseabilidad y examinando sus implicaciones lógicas. El argumento central es que las instituciones económicas deben promover el bienestar social, apoyándose en disciplinas como la filosofía, las matemáticas y la informática. La justicia distributiva ha sido uno de los leitmotiv de la investigación de William. Leer este libro es una delicia, tanto para economistas como no economistas. Les animo, al menos, a leer la introducción. Permítanme, para abrir boca, leer un pequeño párrafo del libro. For sure, economists care about efficiency and incentives, but not so much about fairness. Should they pay more attention to that? Fairness is important. Turn out your television, switch on your computer. Many of the conflicts you see around the world, from the most trivial to the most destructive, have their origin in people not being treated fairly or thinking they aren't, by disagreement about what's a fair distribution of opportunities, decision power, tax revenues, and natural resources. The mere perception on unfairness is often a threat to the social order. The customers of a repair shop complain about the place they have been assigned in a queue for a service. Parents sue school districts, arguing that their child was entitled to a better school. Patients die waiting for kidney or heart transplantation the same day others come home with new kidneys or new hearts. Banks may be too big to fail, but ordinary people lose their homes every day. Is this acceptable? The rise in income inequality in many countries in the last 20 or 30 years has also become a source of concern across much of the political spectrum. It's an income distribution in which a tiny fraction of the population owns most of the wealth, unavoidable or undesirable. What often falls independence movements around the world are disputes over redistribution of tax revenues across regions. The financing of NATO has been the object of recent acrimonious debates. These are just a few examples illustrating the importance of fairness issues in our daily life. You talk about fairness, but what exactly do you mean by that? Yes, what's fairness? Defining fairness isn't that simple. In fact, it's probably just as hard as defining happiness or love. So don't expect from me a single and compact formula. Fairness have components, facets, and themes. My subject is resource allocation and public decisions, and I'll discuss a literature that addresses fairness issues in this context. We'll find that variety of problems that we like to solve is a challenge. Confronting these problems will often lead us to question standard ways of thinking about fairness. To formally express our intuition about what's fair in novel ways, to develop meaningful evaluations of social institutions in terms of fairness, and in the end, of building better ones. I'm not saying that the axiomatic method will deliver easy answers to every kind of allocations or decision problems that society may face, but it offers a conceptual and analytical framework that allows a systematic search for answers. Espero que esta pequeña muestra les permita apreciar lo relevante de este trabajo. Finalmente, en A Guide for Young Economists, publicado en MIT Press en 2001, William vuelca toda la generosidad que impregna su obra y su labor docente. De incalculable valor en los primeros años de la vida académica de un economista, ha sido traducido al chino, japonés, castellano, catalán y ha sido una herramienta esencial para muchos estudiantes de doctorado en todo el mundo, guiándolos en la preparación de sus tesis, sus posteriores artículos y en sus primeras presentaciones en conferencias. Un aspecto especialmente destacable de su trabajo, sus artículos, sus libros, es su generosidad al dar crédito a todos aquellos que de alguna forma han contribuido a la literatura sobre asignación de recursos. Nunca olvida a nadie. Esto refleja no solo su integridad académica, sino también su reconocimiento y aprecio por la colaboración y las ideas de otros investigadores. Además de su magnífica contribución al campo de la economía, me gustaría hacer especial énfasis en algo que espero haya dejado entrever durante esta laudatio: su magisterio, su enorme capacidad de enseñar, su compromiso con la docencia, con su alumnado y con otros estudiantes que están empezando su trayectoria académica. Su dedicación le ha llevado a supervisar a más de medio centenar de estudiantes de doctorado que han realizado contribuciones significativas en economía y se han integrado en el profesorado de instituciones de primer nivel como Harvard, Columbia, Northwestern, Caltech, Carnegie Mellon, Universidad de Michigan, universidades en Japón, Corea, Turquía, Canadá, Bélgica, Taiwán, China, Holanda, la lista es interminable. A esta lista hay que añadir un número similar de estudiantes visitantes que han pasado por Rochester y a los que William ha guiado en sus comienzos. Muchos de sus estudiantes de doctorado y profesores que visitaron Rochester a lo largo de los años están aquí hoy, uniéndose a nosotros en esta ceremonia y participando en la conferencia organizada en honor a William. Permítanme, para terminar, destacar el vínculo que William tiene con la Universidad de Alicante. Este vínculo comenzó en Madrid en 1987, durante un congreso en el que Luis Corchón, profesor de esta casa, entre 1988 y 1997, conoció a William y terminó pasando un sabático en la Universidad de Rochester. A su regreso, Luis se incorporó a la Universidad de Alicante e invitó a William en el año 1989. Durante su visita, William ofreció la lección Germán Bernácer y desde entonces varios de los estudiantes de doctorado de Alicante y posteriormente estudiantes de estos estudiantes han realizado visitas de investigación en Rochester. Además, William ha formado parte de los comités de defensa de tesis de muchos de nosotros que nos doctoramos en Alicante, incluidos Pablo Amorós y Bernardo Moreno, hoy catedráticos de la Universidad de Málaga, Juan de Dios Moreno Ternero, catedrático de la Universidad Pablo de Olavide, Ricardo Martínez, profesor de la Universidad de Granada, y yo misma. Todos estamos presentes hoy aquí como muestra de nuestra estima y nuestro respeto a William. Su influencia ha sido fundamental en nuestras carreras y su compromiso personal ha sido incuestionable. Recuerdo vivamente cómo nos acogía en Rochester, tratándonos con la misma dedicación y cuidado que a sus propios estudiantes. A pesar de las barreras del idioma, William siempre mostraba una paciencia infinita. Con gran generosidad se sentaba con nosotros, revisando párrafo a párrafo nuestros artículos para mejorarlos. Esta paciencia y meticulosidad no solo mejoraron nuestros trabajos, sino que también nos enseñaron el verdadero rigor académico. Su habilidad para explicar conceptos complejos mediante gráficos sencillos ha dejado una huella profunda en todos nosotros. Sus clases, llenas de diagramas claros y explicaciones detalladas, nos permitieron comprender y reproducir formalmente las demostraciones más complicadas. La internacionalización del Departamento de Fundamentos del Análisis Económico comenzó en gran medida gracias al profesor Thompson. Su relación con la Universidad de Alicante ha contribuido a forjar la reputación y el prestigio que la Facultad de Ciencias Económicas y Empresariales goza hoy en día. Merci beaucoup, William. Gracias a todos por compartir este momento con nosotros. Así pues, considerados y expuestos todos estos hechos, dignísimas autoridades y claustrales, solicito con toda consideración y encarecidamente ruego que se otorgue y confiera al doctor William Thompson el supremo grado de doctor honoris causa por la Universidad de Alicante.
La señora secretaria general dará lectura al acta de nombramiento como doctor honoris causa por la Universidad de Alicante a favor del doctor William Thompson.
El Consejo de Gobierno de la Universidad de Alicante, en la sesión ordinaria de 29 de febrero de 2024, acordó por unanimidad proponer como doctor honoris causa a William Thompson, en reconocimiento a los relevantes méritos que concurren en su trayectoria académica, investigadora y profesional, de lo que doy fe como secretaria general, con el visto bueno de la señora rectora magnífica, en Alicante, a 27 de junio de 2024.
¿Estáis de acuerdo en que el doctor William Thompson sea investido como doctor honoris causa?
Lo estamos.
Ya sí, lo otorgamos. Acercaos. Ahora voy a proceder a la solemne colación del título de doctor honoris causa al señor William Thompson. Por la autoridad que nos otorgan las leyes del reino y el Estatuto de la Universidad de Alicante, os conferimos el grado de doctor honoris causa y, como símbolo de tan alto honor, os impongo la medalla como atributo por vuestra incorporación al claustro. Os impongo este birrete cual corona de vuestros estudios y méritos. Ahora os entregaré los atributos de este nombramiento y distinción y os explicaré su significado. He aquí el libro que simboliza los secretos de las ciencias. En vuestra mano pongo este anillo de oro como símbolo de vuestra unión con la ciencia y con esta universidad. Recibid, en fin, los guantes blancos como símbolo de la pureza y la fortaleza que vuestras manos han de conservar y también como signo de vuestra altísima dignidad. Ahora os abrazaré para indicar nuestro mutuo afecto y fraternidad. La señora secretaria general de la universidad se tomará promesa de fidelidad al nuevo doctor.
¿Prometéis observar y cumplir todas y cada una de las normas de la Universidad de Alicante?
Así lo prometo y quiero.
Y en primer lugar, siempre y donde quiera que estuviereis, guardaréis los derechos, los privilegios y el honor de la Universidad de Alicante y la ayudaréis y le prestaréis vuestro concurso, apoyo y consejo en los asuntos universitarios cuantas veces para ello fuereis requerido.
Así lo prometo y quiero.
Recibo vuestra promesa. La Universidad de Alicante es testigo y será juez si faltareis al compromiso. Sentaos. Tiene la palabra el doctor William Thompson. You have the floor. Por favor, un técnico.
Okay, sorry. I'm going to start by saying thank you. Muchas gracias. Gracias. I know that these kinds of honors do not happen by themselves, that someone has to take the initiative to submit a nomination, that rules and procedures have to be figured out, that documents have to be collected, that letters have to be written, that emails, lots of them, have to be sent, even more so if a workshop is attached to the ceremony. Money has to be raised, rooms have to be reserved, receptions, coffee breaks, meals have to be scheduled. So I would first like to thank Carmen Bevia, the primary instigator and local organizer of this event, Pablo Amoros, Bernardo Moreno, Socorro Pri, and Juan Moreno Ternero for having taken all of these steps. Muchas, muchas gracias to all of you. I also understand that Dean Raul Ruiz of the Faculty of Economics at the University of Alicante and Chancellor Amparo Navarro have strongly endorsed the proposal that they received from the nomination committee. I thank both of them for their support. Finally, I thank all of you who are in this room today, in particular those of you who traveled to Alicante, in some cases from very far, to be part of this event. I'm very grateful and happy to see you. What we're celebrating today actually goes much beyond me. We're celebrating a research program that you believe in and in which you have made, and in which many of you in this room have made important contributions. It is fitting that this ceremony is right in the middle of the workshop. I have already enjoyed the presentation of a number of very interesting papers, and I look forward to listening to the remaining ones. Receiving an honor of this kind is very humbling. You can't help thinking about the things that you could have done better, the other papers that you could have written, even finished, why not? How you could have been a better teacher, a better advisor, a better colleague. You also think about how lucky you have been. Here are the multiple ways in which I have been lucky. Also, I grew up in a very small village of 200 people. I've had many great teachers in my life, starting with my parents. My father was a master pedagogue, and I was fortunate to attend the best schools in France and in the US. I was lucky that my first job was at the University of Minnesota in Minneapolis, where Leo Hurwitz, one of the founders of economic design, was my colleague for 4 years. I then had a visiting position at Harvard University for 3 years. In 1983, I landed a job at the University of Rochester, one of the top economics departments in the US. Since then, I've benefited from interacting with a group of incredibly smart and dedicated colleagues and from a tradition of excellence that dates to the foundation of our graduate program by my late colleague, Lionel McKenzie. I was able to ride on the reputation of our department as one of the best training grounds for budding economists. I've been lucky, I would say privileged is a better word, to work with an extraordinary group of talented graduate students. And here are their names. Yongsab Chun, who is here, my very first graduate student. Bhaskar Chakravarti, Larry Kranick, who's also here. Dimitri Diamantaras, Koichi Tanuma, Toshiaki Suematsu, John Conley, Simon Wilkie, Thomas Sostrom, Takehiko Yamato, Shige Serizawa, Kenichi Shimomura, Sang-Yun Son, Sang-Chun Su, Stephen Ching, Typhoon Somnes, Song Wuxin, Terry Kara, James Schumer, Aishi Miyagawa, Andreas Westermark, Toru Hokari, who is here also, Attila Bulk, Attila So in my computer, it is also an issue of spelling of Attila's name. So I created the macro /ABD. So I never misspelled it now. Attila Abdulkader Oglu, Oscar Kibri, Sung Yuk Ri, Byung-gwi Ju, Hun Jun Kim, Jun Jae Ye, Christopher Chambers, who is here, Toyotaka Sakai, Ono Keston, Murat Altamas, Osgur Yilmaz, Toku Yangin, Diego Dominguez, Chai Takai, Jorge Garcia, Rodrigo Velez, who is here, Yoichi Kazajima, Paolo Ramillo, Vikram Manchunas, Azai Abisada, Hun Jun Ho, Aisha Yasizi, Yo Cho, Nanyang Bu, Gao Shwagak, Siwei Chen, Ba Duan, Ryan Tiene, who is here, Will Fan, who is here, Patrick Harless, Andy McKenzie, who is here, Achelia Altundas, Yuki Tamura, Wataru Ishida, and two students still under construction, Changbu Park and Zeming Ma. I would also mention the numerous students at other universities who invited me to be part of their dissertation committees. You will see that there are many Spanish names in this list. So Carmen Bevia was the first one, Thomas Piketty, François Maniquet, Pablo Amoros, Bernardo Moreno, Bettina Klaus, Anne van Delecom, Abdurrahman Ziad, Paolo Cortareal, Lars Ellers, who is here, Sofia Grand, Juan Moreno Ternero, Julio González Díaz, Ricardo Martinez, Marie-Ké Quant, Matteo Triosi, Eve Remacher, Miriam Grote-Schalsberg, Peng Liu, Paz Dissenbacher, who is here, Maria Solis, Oriane Gallo, Difang, Iago Núñez Lugilde. My students have made many fundamental contributions to economics, and many have reached the highest echelons of academics. They have served on the board of multiple economics journals, in some cases served as editors-in-chief, and even founded new journals. They've also been high-level administrators, certainly not something they've learned from me. Indeed, they have been chairs of economics department. I consider it one of my highest academic achievements myself, not just that I never was chair of my own department, but that I was never asked to be. They have been directors of the Economics Research Institute, deans of colleges, one of them has been president of a major university. In addition to these pure scholarly contributions, they have also been involved in a variety of practical decision making. They have worked for public finance research departments and for central banks. They have run the endowment of a university. They have negotiated billion-dollar deals, both as chief economist at the FCC and as representative of a private consulting company. They have played a key role in the improvement of rules to assign students to school and organs to patients in need of transplantation. I would also like to talk about the special role that my Spanish colleagues have had in my life. It all started with Luis Corchon, who visited me in Rochester for a year, and with Carmen Herrero. Their research interest, implementation, and bargaining theory were in perfect alignment with mine. So the very first city in Spain that I visited was Alicante, where the concept of a cloud does not exist, although I saw some recently, and where they invited me on multiple occasions. So people would ask, you went to Spain, but you didn't go to Madrid, you didn't go to Barcelona. I would say, why would I go to Madrid or Barcelona? I went to visit Carmen and Luis and Antonio. They are in Alicante. I eventually did venture beyond Alicante, and as a result of their influence and reputation spread across Spain, thanks to their work and their students, I ended up visiting more cities in Spain than in any other country in the world, except perhaps the US. Alicante, Valencia, Barcelona, Rio, Girona, Madrid, Malaga, Sevilla, Granada, Vigo, Santiago, Bilbao, Girona, Elche. There are indeed so many people in Spain who share my research interest, with whom have I corresponded, have participated in joint sessions at conferences, and whose papers my students and visitors have discussed in the reading group that I hold in my office, papers that have inspired me in my own work. Our exchanges have had to do with many topics, including bargaining, cooperative games, fairness, implementation, various types of allocation problems, of indivisible resources, of non-homogeneous resources, of resources over which people have conflicting claims. This list of Spanish colleagues is quite extraordinary. It would be interesting in writing the intellectual history of Spain to understand why that is the case. Why are there so many people in Spain studying economic design in the axiomatic mode? I'm sure this intellectual history would include Don Quixote. Yet there is a bit of Don Quixote in anyone working on the axiomatic of economic design. More recently, Carmen and Carmen and Lewis would have to be cited as the main influencers directly through their own work and indirectly through their students and grand students, perhaps grand students. I don't know whether they have any yet. So here's a list then. So we started with Carmen Herrero, Luis Corchon, Carmen Pevia, Antonio Villar, Mary Carmen Marco. So these are all people with whom I've interacted over so many years and so many times. Next, Cory Villeya, who invited me to Rio several times and translated my guide for young economists into Catalan. Thanks to her, I have a publication in Catalan. José Manuel Jiménez Gómez, Pablo Amoros, Bernardo Moreno, Socorro Puy. So Socorro, once after a presentation I gave, Socorro came to me and said, "This time you did a good job." So if your ego needs to be deflated, there's nothing like being on the wrong end of one of Socorro's compliments. So Guadalupe, I continue with my list. Guadalupe Correa, José Sarzuelo, Javier Arin, Elena Iñara, Oriane Gallo, Miguel Alvarez Mozos, Antonio Medina Romero, Amparo Marmol, Juan Moreno Ternero. So Juan has been, I would say, a merciless proofreader of several of my book projects. So when I was at college, I used to have a math teacher. And when we gave our homework assignment, he would read only the first mistake he would find. So that would be typically the second or third line. And he would say, "J'arrête." It means I stop. And he would grade you on whatever he had left. And so basically you always get zero. And so Juan, on the other hand, read what you write until the last mistake, which typically would be on the last but one line of the last paragraph or the last page. And he say, "Paro." Para? Paro. So needless to say, if he were to, he never gave me a grade, but needless to say, if he did, that would also be zero. So I continue my list. So Encarnacion Algabar is also someone who invited me on many occasions to visit in Spain, and she most recently asked me to be part of a big project on the Shapley value. She loves the Shapley value. Joaquim Sanchez Soriano, Estela Sanchez Rodriguez, who very recently sent me a very extensive list of comments on one of my papers, Gustavo Begontinos, Juan Vidal Puca, Leticia Lorenzo, Ricardo Martinez, Elena Molis, Salvador Papera, Marina Nunez, Carlos Rafael, the list goes on and on, Julio González Rias, Ignacio García Jurado, Ana Meca, Pedro Calera, Frances Irana, Arantxa Estevez Fernandez, and many others whose name I will also be able to mispronounce, as I just did. So my apologies to anyone whose name I would have forgotten. So many of those people have visited me in Rochester for stays of anywhere between a few days to an entire year. When in Spain, I've always found my host to be warm, unpretentious, and welcoming, fun to be with, and easygoing. To illustrate how relaxed Spanish people can be, when you visit a Spanish university for a seminar, you spend a lot of time having coffees. You have coffee when you arrive on campus. You have coffee in the middle of the morning. After all, you need a break after checking your email. You have coffee after lunch. Who doesn't need coffee after lunch? You have coffee before your seminar, and you have coffee after your seminar. In fact, you may well forget that you are visiting to give a seminar. So once I remembered, and I asked Lewis, and I said, "By the way, at what time is my seminar?" His answer, "Don't worry about it." It's true. That's what he said. I wasn't worried, though. I just wanted to know the time of a seminar. So in summary, I'd like to say that Spain has been a sort of academic paradise for me. So I thank all of my Spanish colleagues, not only for unflagging dedication to economic design and to the axiomatic approach to design, but also for the kind and repeated hospitality. So closing the list of the many ways in which I have been lucky, I found a line of work, I should say a line of play, that was well suited to my interests and abilities. In fact, I don't think there's much else I could have done with my life. I'm confident that if I had been a civil engineer, most of my bridges would have collapsed and the others would be unfinished. If I had been an accountant, all my clients would be in prison, the others would be living in Switzerland. And if I had been a doctor, most of my patients would be dead and the others would be on life support. So I recognize this and I chose economic theory. So the beauty of theory is that if you screw up, nobody is swept away by the raging waters, nobody ends up in prison, and nobody dies. So the theory of economic design has to do with the search for the best way of making collective decisions when people have different opinions about what should be done, which I think is always. And how to distribute resources in which the possible recipients have conflicting interests and over which they have conflicting claims, which again, I think is always. Economic design is not about things, about how things are, but how better we can make them. The motto of my university is meliora, better things. And that's what economic design is about, making things better. And when people ask me, and what about the real world? I simply reply, let's not forget that the real world is just an example. And here I could be citing respectively Sancho Panza and Don Quixote again, right? Sancho Panza for the question and Don Quixote for the answer. So more precisely, and this is a serious part of my presentation here, more precisely, what is economic design? For those of you in the room who are not economists, I'd like to describe in a few words what it's about and what the axiomatic approach to design consists of. I could refer you to the book I just published last year about the axiomatic of economic design, but what I'm going to say will save you from having to read it. Economic design starts with a specification of a class of decision problem to be solved, typically allocation problem, you know, how to distribute goods in a refugee camp, but there also could be about the choice of a public alternative, like the temperature at which to set the thermostat in this room. When facing a decision problem in some class, three questions can be asked. Question number one, what do we do? Question number two, what could we do? Question number three, what should we do? The axiomatic method is constructive, not descriptive, but the answers to question number one, what do we actually do, is not uninteresting because on occasion societies have spontaneously found good solutions to problems, solutions that in fact have sometimes come out of axiomatic work. We answer question number two, what could we do, by throwing our net for inspiration as widely as possible on previous literature, but mainly by giving free rein to our imagination. The exercise quickly reveals the limited range of solutions that I use in practice. Answering question number three, what should we do, is where the axiomatic method enters the picture. The axiomatic method provides conceptual and methodological tools to answer it. So let me elaborate by means of a series of question and answer. First, what is an axiom? It's a good idea to define the object you're going to talk about. An axiom, for me, this is my formal definition, an axiom is the expression in mathematical form of some intuition we have about how a solution mapping should be required to behave or could be required to behave in particular situation. So what do I say in mathematical form? Because axiomatic work is analytical and formal. We want to go beyond a soft discussion of the issues and obtain precise and implementable answers to a specific question of design. What do I say? Some intuition? Because axioms have to resonate. The axioms are either the expression of the aspiration of society, they reflect philosophical views, people's judgment about how things should be, in particular how conflict should be resolved. Or axioms are formulated in response to the concerns that the participant will behave strategically when confronted to a solution. They may take advantage of the opportunities that the solution may give them to push a decision in a direction that favors them. So we have to do something about that. And what do I say? How solution mapping should be required to behave or could be required to behave, because it is pointless to insist that the solution should satisfy any particular axiom in isolation. Whether a solution can satisfy an axiom depends on the other axioms that are imposed on it. However, a solution could be required to satisfy a particular axiom, if possible, given the other demand placed on it. So axiom as the atoms of the theory, the building blocks from which we construct solution. The axioms it satisfies are the reasons why we will be interested in particular solutions. So next question, what does an axiomatic study look like? An axiomatic study starts with the formulation of axioms of a certain type, and it aims to figure out their compatibilities when imposed in various combinations. Axiom studies delivers two kinds of results. Sometimes, when the list of axioms is too extensive, and not surprisingly, the outcome is an impossibility result. On the other hand, when the axioms in the list are compatible, an axiomatic study provides as complete as possible a description of the solution or solutions with an S that satisfies them all. Such a result is a characterization theorem. Next question. Now, what is the overall goal of the axiomatic program as a whole? It is to trace out the boundary between those combinations of axioms that are compatible and those combinations that are not. Axioms are usually yes or no proposition, but sometimes they can be parameterized, and explicit numerical trade-off between those parameters can be described. Next question, what is the intellectual foundation of the axiomatic program in economic design? I would say that economic design was made possible by three major developments in economic theory in the second half of the 20th century. First, general equilibrium theory, which elaborated the canonical model of a classical economy, introduced many mathematical tools that turned out to be critical to the study of economic design. However, economic design concerned a multitude of types of allocation of parameters of which the classical model is just one example. Second, Arrian social choice theory, which addressed the question of what could be done and what should be done in unstructured, abstract environment. In answering those questions, it showed that the axiomatic could play a central role. By contrast, economic design deals with models that are equipped with a variety of mathematical structures that are not present in our view on social choice theory, the topological structure, an order structure, and a vector space structure, typically. These structures suggest the imposition of properties and preferences that are not meaningful without them, such as continuity, monotonicity, convexity. They allow the formulation of axioms that are not meaningful in abstract social choice theory, such as continuity and various kinds of monotonicity, just example. And solutions can be defined that take advantage of these structures and not available without them. Example, and the Shapley value, the complete equilibrium. Those cannot be defined in the Arrian framework. Third, game theory, which is motivated by the recognition that economic agents may take advantage of their unique access to certain kinds of information and to certain resources, information and resources that the designer needs in order to apply solutions. Game theory develops the concept and tools that allow us to understand what to expect of the participant in such situations and provide them with incentives to behave in a way that is compatible with the implementation of social objectives. The so-called cooperative branch of game theory has also offered a variety of social concepts that have been invaluable in the design program. I should add that in the last 10 years, computer science has contributed in techniques and concepts that have considerably enriched the theory of economic design. So, returning to axiomatic work, when different axiom combinations lead to different solutions, how should the theorist choose? I would say that it's not for the theorist to choose, but rather for the user of the theory, whoever has a responsibility of making decisions in the real world. It would depend on the class of problem, on the investigation. So, this decision maker could be the taxation authority, the bankruptcy judge, the superintendent of a school district, the director of a resettlement program, the housing authority of a city or of a university, the medical organization assigning medical students to training programs or organs to patients in a transplantation program, the international agency distributing water rights, the sport organization, and so on. So how would the user of the theory decide? Well, they would have to evaluate the relative importance of punctual consideration of efficiency and fairness in situations in which the parameters of the problems to be solved may vary. They may have to consider relational axioms of solidarity and robustness to the choice of perspective in evaluating changes in the data of a problem. Mm-hmm. Another consideration is whether the participant should be expected to be strategic about their preferences, about the preferences they control, and what they know about the world. So, if it is not the designer's job to choose, what is their job? I think you can picture a book, on each page of which is a description of the solution or solutions that satisfy particular set of axioms. The user of the theory will decide which axiom is most relevant to them. They will flip the pages of this book to find the page or pages on which the combination of axioms that are most pertinent to them are discussed. Because the same combination of axioms will often lead to different answers depending upon the context, and may depend upon the mathematical structure of the classical problem under investigation, the job of the designer is actually to produce not just one book, but an entire set of books of this type, one for each type of problem. So I will close with a list of concrete examples of the questions that axiomatic work has allowed us to answer. So, first example, when a firm goes bankrupt and its creditors show up to get their money back, how much should each of them get? The data here are the claims held by the creditors and the liquidation value of the firm. What was that claims problem? Second, when several towns decide to join forces to build a facility that they will all use, but that each of them could not afford on its own, let's say a recycling plant or hospital, how should the cost of the facility be distributed among them? The data here has the resources that each town has access to, or the benefit it derives from the facility, or perhaps both. So the cost allocation problem. Third, when the graduates of medical school have to be assigned to medical program for internship, who should go where? The data is the preference of each entity over the entities with which it could be paired. So there are two-sided pairing problems. Fourth, how should university students be given of a given gender be paired to be assigned to dorm rooms? The data is the preference of each student over all others as possible roommates. As compared to the previous example, here are no constraints on who may be paired with whom. So I call that no-side pairing problems. Five, how should society be organizing groups to engage in joint activities? The data is the preference of each individual over the group to which they could be part of. Group formation problem. Six, when the faculty of an academic department move to a new building, who should be assigned which office? The data is the preferences of each faculty of officers. An office is an indivisible resource. We call that an object. So those are object allocation problems. Seven, it could be that each of the members of a group of people has been assigned an indivisible resource on the basis of information that could not include their preferences, and that a reallocation could be beneficial to them once preferences are known. How should this be done? The data here include everyone's preferences over the resources, so the object reallocation problem. Eight, who should get the next available kidney in a transplantation program? The data here include the specification of which object each agent can actually consume. Not all assignments are possible. Those are object allocation problems with feasibility constraints. Nine, in a school district, to which school should each student be assigned? The data here consists of the preferences of each student over the schools, and for each school, a priority order over the student. So a priority augmented object allocation problem. 10, when the teacher in the natural educational system want to move to different cities, how should the Ministry of Education reassign them? The data here includes the data of the previous item plus some initial assignment. Those are priority augmented object reallocation problem. Which student should get which room in the house of a group of students are renting together, and how much of a contribution to the rent should each of them make? The data here has a preference of each student over pairs consisting of one of the rooms and some monetary contribution to the rent. So the money and object allocation problem. When a group of people are waiting for a service, in what order should they be served? And how much should each of them contribute to the cost of running the facility providing the service? The data here includes the cost of waiting for each agent and the time it takes to serve them. So the queuing problem. How should the revenue generated by broadcasting rights be shared by the team of a soccer league? The data here includes the paying audience of each match played by each pair of teams and total revenue to be allocated. So the tournament-based money allocation problem. When agents are linearly ordered and some amount of resource is available to each agent that can only be transferred down the line, how much of the resource should each agent end up having control over be transferred to the next one? How much of the resource each agent ends up having control over should be transferred to the next one? So data include an order on the agent set, and for each agent, an amount of resource that arrives directly at that agent. So the reverse sharing problem or intergenerational allocation. So those are just some among many type of allocation problems that have been extensively studied in the theory of economic design. So I think it's time to conclude. I was hooked on the axiomatic mode of reasoning the very first time I read Nash's paper when I was a grad student, Nash's 1950 paper. And economic design was born under my very eyes when I was a graduate student and a young assistant professor. It is extremely gratifying to me to see the considerable development it has experienced since, in large part thanks to the axiomatic method, and in large part to your contributions. New classes of problems are discovered every day that are amenable to it. I have no doubt that the theory of economic design will continue to play a central role in the derivation of good solutions to problems that people face in their daily life. So, again, thank you for all coming. Muchas gracias. Remember that if any of you wants to visit me in Rochester, I'll be more than happy to welcome you in September. It's not too late to make your plane reservation. In the meantime, I wish everyone a great axiomatic summer.
Ilustrísimo director general de universidades, señor vicerrector de investigación, señora vicerrectora de Relaciones Internacionales y Cooperación para el Desarrollo, señora secretaria general, doctor honoris causa, profesor Thompson, catedrática, profesora Carmen Bebiá, equipo de dirección, decanos, director de la Escuela Politécnica Superior, autoridades académicas, comunidad universitaria, señoras y señores, sean mis primeras palabras para agradecerles a todos ustedes su presencia en el acto de la solemne investidura como doctor honoris causa por la Universidad de Alicante del profesor William Thompson, al que quiero felicitar por este reconocimiento y, por supuesto, por la trayectoria investigadora y docente que le ha hecho merecedor de tan alto honor. Mi agradecimiento también y mi felicitación a la madrina del nuevo doctor, la profesora Carmen Bebiá, profesora de Fundamentos del Análisis Económico, por su magnífica laudatio cargada de emoción y de conocimiento de la vida y obra de nuestro honoris. También mi enhorabuena al Departamento de Fundamentos del Análisis Económico por la oportunidad de la propuesta de investir como doctor honoris causa al profesor Thompson, refrendada por unanimidad por el claustro de la Facultad de Ciencias Económicas y Empresariales y por el Consejo de Gobierno de la Universidad de Alicante. Doctor Thompson, mi felicitación en nombre de la Universidad de Alicante por su excelente carrera académica, profesional e investigadora, por sus contribuciones a la economía, por sus relaciones con nuestra universidad y por su extraordinario discurso. Recibid nuestra calurosa bienvenida a nuestro claustro, ahora también el suyo. La carta de presentación del doctor Thompson como catedrático de la Universidad de Rochester, una de las mejores universidades del mundo y como maestro y referente de los más prestigiosos economistas de nuestro país, sería suficiente para que nos sintiéramos sumamente honrados de incorporarlo a nuestro claustro. Pero, a mi entender, esos dos méritos son solo el resultado de una larga trayectoria académica e investigadora que, como nos ha resaltado la profesora Bebiá, ha estado al servicio de una línea de investigación tan relevante como es, en definitiva, la asignación de recursos y la justicia distributiva. La divulgación científica en un tema tan difícil como la economía y la docencia y formación académica de jóvenes investigadores. La economía es una ciencia social, aun en sus aspectos más cuantitativos y matemáticos, y por eso ha permitido al doctor Thompson desarrollar investigaciones que han dado lugar a aportaciones muy relevantes para el fomento de la justicia en la toma de decisiones a través del análisis axiomático. Como jurista, no he podido dejar de pensar, oyendo su discurso, en la contribución de los ciudadanos al sostenimiento de los gastos públicos a través de los tributos o en la distribución posterior de esos recursos obtenidos en forma de gasto público, respecto del cual nuestra Constitución, la Constitución española, establece una asignación equitativa y eficaz. Y, asimismo, como rectora, estaría encantada de añadir más ejemplos que tal vez podría o debería responder mediante el método axiomático: distribución de plazas de profesorado, distribución de espacios, distribución del presupuesto, siempre bajo la premisa de más necesidades que recursos. Con esto, lo que quiero transmitir a esta audiencia es el impacto de una investigación de excelente calidad como la que desarrolla el profesor Thompson para la resolución de los problemas de los ciudadanos. También me gustaría, doctor Thompson, explicarle lo que es un doctor honoris causa para la Universidad de Alicante. En la universidad en la que creemos, el éxito no se valora en beneficio económico, ni siquiera en el impacto numérico de una plataforma tecnológica. Se valora en excelencia académica y en aportaciones investigadoras que nos ayuden a conocer el mundo y la sociedad que nos rodea. Los honoris representan los valores de bondad, solidaridad y servicio público que solo hombres y mujeres como usted representan. Si hoy el claustro de la Universidad de Alicante tuviera que elegir entre diferentes soluciones ofrecidas por la teoría de axiomas, usted sería nuestra elección, sin ninguna duda. Asimismo, quiero agradecer su contribución y sus excelentes lazos con la Universidad de Alicante. Nuestra universidad se sitúa en una ciudad mediterránea de tamaño medio, pero que destaca por grupos de investigación muy punteros y con fuertes lazos de internacionalización, como el de Fundamentos del Análisis Económico, cuyos miembros tanto le admiran y que tantas cosas le agradecen. Por eso quiero terminar este discurso como empecé, con mi agradecimiento a los presentes y mi más sincera enhorabuena de nuevo, doctor Thompson, que hago extensiva a sus familiares y amigos y a toda la Universidad de Alicante por poder contar con usted entre nuestros más ilustres doctores. Muchas gracias y feliz día.
Todos en pie.
levanta la sesión. Thank you.